Some call in sick and some suffer in silence. Some end up quitting their jobs altogether. For thousands of Aussie women, menopause is upending their lives and their careers, and it's costing our economy billions. Now there are calls for women to receive paid leave.
Shrouded in silence and shame.
Headaches and insomnia, changes in our mood, anxiety and feelings of stress. These can come unexpectedly for women, and that can be really difficult to manage in the workplace.
Across the nation, women are quitting their careers early, one quarter retiring before the age of 55. Australia's peak union body placing the blame on workplaces failing to support women going through menopause.
Women are reporting that their work really doesn't properly consider the impact of menopause on them. There's this culture of silence. It's still a bit of a taboo issue.
On average, women are retiring 7 years earlier than men and 12 years earlier than they had originally planned.
80% of them saying work is affected, but 70% say they don't feel confident to raise it with their boss or their manager.
Menopause estimated to cost Aussie women a collective $15.2 billion in lost income and super for every year of early retirement. The union today pushing for 10 days paid reproductive leave and flexible conditions for women going through menopause, taking their case to a Senate inquiry examining the health and financial impacts of menopause and perimenopause.
Pain that is relentless and unrecognised and tolerated.
Menopause usually hits between the ages of 45 and 55. Perimenopause, which can last up to 10 years, can begin in a woman's 30s. One quarter experience symptoms that profoundly affect their daily working lives.
Many women say, I feel like I'm going through early dementia, and that can be really difficult to talk about at work, worrying that it will mean that they look not as competent at their jobs.
By 2030, 25% of the female population will be menopausal, making women in this life stage the fastest growing demographic in the Australian workforce. So, as our population ages, is it time we break the stigma?
It'll be feared that they're pathetic creatures at the mercies of their hormones.
And shift from silence to support.
The best way to counteract this is to bring it out into the open. We need to stop whispering about menopause in the corridors and talking about this normal, natural life phase that everyone will go through who's born with ovaries.
Journalist Patrina Jones hosts the Rage Against the Menopause podcast and joins us now. Patrina, your career is absolutely flying, but you've been dealing with perimenopause behind the scenes. What have you been coping with day to day?
You know, the worst thing probably is the lack of sleep. So doing breakfast radio on Gold FM, I'm up at 3 a.m. because I do the news. And, you know, some nights it can be just like 3 or 4 hours sleep, and not because I'm stressed, or it's just because I can't sleep because of the sleeplessness. And then through the day, I do want to sleep when I can't sleep. Hot flushes, all the typical sort of things. But the symptoms are so wide. There are so many of them. And you don't know if it's that or if it's you. You know, you're spinning a million different plates, you're a mum, you've got elderly parents, a busy career. It can really mess with your head some days.
Patrina, so it's not just women necessarily suffering from this, but it's also the people who work with the women who also suffer. They also suffer. The men at our desk. They want to hear more about that.
We are not suffering anything in any way.
We're very happy with how everything is going.
What are some of the other stories that you've heard about how it does affect women who are in the workplace?
Well, I have a big thing myself with imposter syndrome. You do lose an amount of self-confidence, and there's depression for some women as well. And the other thing is, when you've worked decades, like we all have, to build up in our careers, you know, you don't want to be seen as sort of backing off in the workplace, and you don't want to fess up to say, hey, you know what, I'm having a really bad day today for fear of, you know, I've worked decades to get to this point and I don't want to be seen as weak.
Obviously, you can understand then why for some women these symptoms might make them want to leave the workforce early.
Yep.
But what can be done about that?
Well, I love that the ACTU today has come out and suggested we have menopause leave, but I really think we could go further. I think we've got to be careful not to just target menopause. I think it should be other types of leave for endometriosis, polycystic ovarian syndrome. I think if we're going to do it, let's do it right. We're finally getting the ball rolling, but we're just scratching the surface.
Yeah, also then, because imagine you work at Hooters and you have to go in and say, excuse me, honey, I want to take my menopause leave.
I don't think I'd get a job there, Kate.
How's that going to go over with the boss?
I'd like to think my boobies were still that perky, Kate.
I have no thoughts on anything we've just been talking about. I do want your thoughts, though, on the ACTU's proposal. So you said you'd like it broadened, but any way you cut it, they're talking about 10 days' worth of leave.
Yeah.
And then some flexibility stuff. So yep. I just don't quite understand how big the problem would be for workers, though. Would 10 days' leave make that much difference? Would flexibility make the difference? Or would it need to be something more thoroughgoing than that?
Look, I think it's a good start. I think it's a good start. I think 10 days would be brilliant, particularly on those nights where you don't sleep and you wake up and you just simply can't function. Let's see how it goes and tweak it if we need to.
And what about getting the basics right, Patrina? I mean, do we need more affordable access to more effective HRT therapy? I mean, some of these medications can cost women up to $100 every month.
Yeah, it's a lot. And you know what? The other thing, Sarah, is access to HRT patches. There's been, like, a bit of a worldwide shortage since the COVID lockdowns. So I think it's still got a bad rap. You know, it's not for everyone. I think everyone has to find the thing that works for them, which also, you know, doctors, I think, need to be a little bit more savvy too. I've had a couple of listeners message me just in the last week, and one said she went to her doctor and said, look, I'm really not feeling right, not realising that she was in perimenopause. And he said to her, look, it's really just all in your head, love, you know, go home. Let's not discount that. I think a woman knows her body better than anyone else.
Patrina, thanks so much for chatting with us. It's been great.
You're welcome.